greatly impact users as the app is crucial for communication in organizations that do business with China. Uber's delivery service is booming. It's now the company's biggest source of revenue. Second quarter revenue from Eats was $1.2 billion, which is double what it was a year ago. At the same time, though, Uber's ride-sharing service fell 67%. Over that time period, gross bookings for rides dropped 73%, while Eats bookings grew 113%. Even with the jump from Uber Eats, the company lost $1.8 billion during the second quarter. The company cut about 6,700 jobs. If you're taking a flight, you may want to keep the alcohol at home. Due to the COVID-19 pandemic, airlines have been reconsidering the services offered to passengers. Some have cut back on offering adult beverages. They say that has led passengers to believe they can bring their own supply aboard. However, that's not the case. Personal alcohol is not permitted on planes under any circumstances. Alcohol bought from duty-free has to be kept sealed. And those getting packages from UPS could see an increase in price during the holidays. That's because of the coronavirus pandemic. The company says it'll add surcharges for delivery on big items, but it won't affect customers buying small goods. The surcharge will cost between $1 and $4. The cost can also vary depending on whether delivery is by ground or air. After months of not seeing each other face-to-face, families reunited with their children at a long-term care facility. The special moments after the break.
And here's a look at our Grovetown Live-By. This is looking towards a good storm over Thompson and McDuffie County. Give you a radar check and a look at the weekend coming up.
Idea, especially in South Carolina.
Coronavirus forced hospitals across the country to ban visitors. That's created a rough situation for some parents who've not been allowed to see their sick children face to face. But families in one community now reuniting with their kids as visiting restrictions have been lifted. Vladimir Dufayer captured the special moments.
For the first time in nearly 5 months, Catherine Rivera was able to hold her daughter Maria in her arms. Back in March, the long-term care unit at the Blythedale Children's Hospital stopped allowing all visitors, including parents, to protect immunocompromised patients like Maria.
She looks so big. She's grown. It's a big relief. Really, really big relief.
The 4.5-year-old has spent nearly her entire life in the hospital. Before she was born, she was diagnosed with a rare joint disease, a condition with no cure.
She's been a fighter. I mean, she's beat all the odds. Doctors didn't have much hope, but she proved them wrong.
Since the hospital lifted its visiting restrictions last week, there have been more than a dozen emotional reunions between children and their families. Some, like Catherine, cope with the distance through regular video calls.
It wasn't the same as, you know, hugging her and carrying her. There were days where it was really hard on me.
But what got Rivera through 145 days of not being able to touch Maria was knowing her daughter was in good hands.
We don't call them nurses or doctors. We call them our aunts and uncles. They are family to us. They're amazing. I wasn't worried about her missing me because she has enough love here.
These kids already have such a tough battle to fight. It's a beautiful thing that they don't have to fight this one anymore, being able to reconnect with their families.
Mm-hmm. Touching video there, you could even see the smiles on their faces. Thank you to those frontline workers.
Beautiful children. To weather now, this is a look over Grovetown. Some storms coming just beyond that area, too. Riley, you're tracking storms around the Thompson area.
Exactly right, Sierra. This is a good-looking storm, and it is producing some very heavy rain, a lot of cloud-to-ground lightning, maybe even some gusty winds starting to pick up with this. It is showing signs of strengthening on radar, so here's the latest hour scan of it. You can see it's moving towards the northeast, producing some very heavy rain over Thompson, Deering as well, the public fishing area there just outside of Deering. That's crossing over into Columbia County, so places like Harlem, you're going to be next. Appling, you could be clipped by this, and then Grovetown. We're just going to be continuing next in line. So this is going to be trying to travel down that I-20 corridor. And a wider look at the region, you can see the coverage of storms is definitely increasing. Some better storms there in the southern CSRA, Barnwell, Bamberg, Allendale County starting to get in on the action. So as we see all these outflow boundaries just kind of interact with one another, we are expecting better coverage of showers and storms as we head later into this evening. Here's a look in the southern CSRA between Midville, Summertown, Swainsboro. Just some good-looking storms there starting to pop up, interacting with some outflows, and that extends all the way to Jenkins County near Millen as well. In Bardwell County, Bamberg, just more peppered heavy rain showers over SRS right there. Bordering Aiken County, they got a good little downpour over them as well. So through this evening, we are expecting these storms to be with us the next several hours. It's not going to be until around midnight before we are completely dry across the area. So just watch out for these storms. If you hear thunder, remember you are close enough to be struck by lightning. So as soon as you do hear that thunder, make sure you're getting inside. Lows tonight are expected to drop to the low 70s for most of us. And then tomorrow afternoon, expect to be hot, but not expecting as many storms. Storm coverage should remain isolated for the most part tomorrow afternoon. So if you do have to get any chores done in the yard, I try to do it early when it's not quite so hot. We should be generally in the 70s up until around 9, 10 o'clock. But later into the afternoon as we heat up, we'll see a few storms form. I'm not going completely dry for the weekend by any means. We're just not expecting as high of rain chances. So I wouldn't cancel any outdoor plans you have, but just watch out for a stray shower storm passing through later into the day. Our high temperatures expect to be right where they are this afternoon. Mid-90s again for your Saturday, and those feel-like temperatures will definitely make it feel worse than that. Any plans for the lake Saturday? Isolated storms possible, but I would keep your lake plans. Just that opportunity is going to be there for a quick little 15-minute shower, but not enough to really cancel your plans up at the lake. It is going to be very hot, though, both days, so be sure you're staying hydrated and protect yourself from the sun as well. By early next week, we're seeing those storm chances increase, but each day over the next 7 going to be seasonal or a little bit above average.
Well, Mike Tyson will be facing an interesting opponent this weekend, and it's happening underwater. More on the interesting battle after the break.
On your side, this is News 12 at 6 o'clock.
A fiery crash near the Allendale County Airport with two people on board. We'll take you out there as crews clean up the crash site. And it's just a driving range now, but this time next year, it'll look a lot different. What a couple of former pros are doing to get Aiken on the golf world's map. But first tonight, we're learning Greenbrier High School has a positive COVID case. Now, 4 of the 5 Columbia County high schools have each had a positive case. Greenbrier joins Evans, Harlem, and Lakeside high schools that have seen cases. Grovetown is the only Columbia County high school without a case. Kids in Columbia County started going back to school on Monday on a hybrid schedule. Today, all those students were virtual as scheduled. The students who are virtual only start Monday. Meanwhile, students in Aiken County start August 31st and Richmond County start September 8th. Today, we're learning exactly how many students will be learning virtually in Aiken County. 6,800 students, or 33% of their kids, will all be virtual. In Richmond County, 57% of kids are virtual, and in Columbia County, 22%. With all these kids learning online, at least for part of the week, parents still have questions about the process. Brady Trapnell shows us what virtual learning will look like.
Back in the spring, it was hit or miss with online learning. But school districts made some changes, and in Columbia County, those are already being noticed.
Walking the hallways comes with its own challenges. Surfing the web comes with change.
And there were definitely things like communication that we wanted to improve upon.
Nick Carroll is the digital learning director for Columbia County Schools.
So you go here, they will click class link.
He says learning from home is as simple as logging in from the school's website.
She's in middle school. She has a middle school folder. She has access to any of these resources that might be linked to her.
There's one link, and my child has access to all of her work there.
Carsa Jones' daughter, Ava, is in the sixth grade. She says there were too many links before.
The teachers actually send out the work, and she's had work already. So it's more organized than it was last spring.
Columbia County says it's Google Classroom that keeps it all in one place.
So just like your Zoom, a student would go into their classroom.
Each class has its unique video chat link. District officials say training is helping to keep everyone on the same page. There's a little over 400 Google certified teachers, and parents even have their own training videos now. But if your child is still struggling, try to make the learning space better at home.
maybe the best place for the computer to be is not on the dining room table. Maybe it's a spot in the room.
The deadline to register for Richmond County's online academy was at 5 o'clock. They had extended that deadline, but they will start distributing laptops on August 17th. Reporting in Augusta, Brady Trapnell on your side.
Aiken County's Innovate program will start the same day as their hybrid option on August 31st. We will have all the links to the plans on our website. As South Carolina parents wait to see if they'll be able to use CARES Act money for private school tuition, we're looking at how much independent schools got in Paycheck Protection Program loans. We found a little more than 100 independent schools in South Carolina received PPP loans larger than $150,000. Independent school leaders said these low-interest loans are helping keep their staff employed, and at some schools, it's keeping them afloat during the pandemic.
To look outside now, this is Grovetown. We can see the ominous clouds, severe weather warnings coming through our area, Riley.
Exactly right, Sierra. We are seeing these storms really starting to fire up, and they are turning intense. We have our first severe thunderstorm warning of the day for portions of Jefferson, Johnson, and Emanuel counties. We are tracking the possibility of 60-mile-per-hour gusts, maybe even quarter-size hail, and a lot of lightning with these storms as well. So if you're anywhere between Swainsboro and Louisville into around Garfield there in Emanuel County, need to get inside, stay away from windows, and let this storm pass. A little bit further north, this is the storm we were just looking at, our Grovetown cam. That's moving out of McDuffie County into southern Columbia County. So places like Evans, Martinez, Grovetown, Harlem, Appling, this storm is going to be barreling towards the Augusta Metro. And why it's concerning is we have this outflow boundary dropping south that's going to collide with that storm. It's likely going to bring up that intensity. So if you live anywhere near the Augusta Metro, try to get your car into a garage, carport, anything like that, because this storm will definitely be capable of producing some strong wind gusts, maybe even some hail as well. So we're going to keep a close eye on this. We'll have much more coming up in that full forecast.
Scary moments today as a plane crashes near the Allendale County Airport. New in the last hour, we know the NTSB could have some preliminary answers on what happened in the next week or two. Two people on board survived and were taken to the hospital. Will Rio tells us what happened.
Emergency crews are continuing their investigation into a small passenger plane that crashed near the Allendale County Airport. Now, first responders did say when they arrived on scene, they found the airplane in pieces and it was fully engulfed.
This was the scene just 1 mile south of the Allendale County Airport off of Highway 278. At 10:41 this morning, emergency crews received a call that a plane had crashed into the woods. You can see here the plane was in pieces. Allendale Fire Chief Franklin Stanley said when crews arrived, the plane was on fire. According to the FAA, the aircraft was a single-engine passenger plane and had two people on board. Both passengers survived and were flown to different hospitals outside the county. The FAA will lead the investigation. The NTSB says they will then determine the cause of the crash. Reporting in Allendale County, Will Rio, on your side.
And we spoke with the NTSB about 45 minutes ago. They are investigating this, but officials will not be traveling here to do that. They say that's actually standard protocol for this type of crash and has nothing to do with COVID.
A big jump in Georgia COVID cases today. New positive tests today.
And as we told you, AU Health set a record on Wednesday with almost 29% of people tested that day positive.
So is that an outlier or part of a trend? Kennedy Harris went to AU Health today to find out. Richmond County has seen a steady rise in positive COVID-19 case numbers recently, but our local doctors are worried about where a continued rise could potentially take us.
Dr. John Farr, the chief medical officer at Doctors Hospital, says in the last 2 weeks, Richmond County has seen an increase in case numbers. Since the pandemic started, the county has had more than 4,000 cases. A third of those cases have come in the last 2 weeks.
So what we're seeing now is folks are tired of it. They want to get back to normal, and they're not consistently employing those three tools that we have to reduce the spread of the virus. So what you see with the increase in cases are the effects of that.
According to the Georgia Department of Public Health, the positivity rate for our area has increased to 17%, and around half of those positive cases are in Richmond. The state of Georgia is now closely monitoring the county as a potential hotspot area.
The reason they do that is, number one, you want to do your best you can to protect those that live in your area, but also, especially important on our standpoint, is that we don't want to overwhelm our medical capacity of the hospitals.
The Department of Health labeled Richmond County as an area with a high exposure rate. Dr. Farr says the rising case numbers threaten hospital capabilities.
And that's why we want to reduce the spread as best we can, and that's why we monitor data so closely.
As far as what's to come, Dr. Farr says it all depends on us following the precautions we know help.
We all want to get back to normal, but the unfortunate fact of the matter is normal's not going to happen until we get good treatment options, until we get a vaccine. So we all have to kind of come to grips with the fact that normal is still a little ways away.
And Dr. Farr says hospitals in our area are full, but they have not yet reached the point where they are overwhelmed. In Augusta, Kennedy Harris, on your side.
An update now to an I-team investigation into school nurses. Tonight, the district tells our I-team it has 35 registered nurses, but three vacancies. Two of their nurses are part-time. We're also told six school nurses decided not to return to school this year. Earlier this summer, we told you South Carolina's school superintendent wanted a nurse in every school across the state as kids went back to class in the middle of this pandemic. You can check out Richmond and Columbia County's numbers on WRDW.com. Black Lives Matter protests becoming less happening in Appling leading up to the Amazon Distribution Center, and this work will involve labor. Road work happening in Appling leading up to the Amazon Distribution Center, and this work will involve lane closures on I-20. Crews are working to widen the bridge on Appling-Harlem Highway, which goes over I-20. GDOT says it will lead to some lane closures and delays on I-20 throughout the weekend. The work starts at 6:30 tonight and goes until Monday morning. The entire road project won't be finished until 2022.
We do have a strong storm heading our way here in the Augusta Metro. This is now moving over Harlem, Appling, Grovetown. This is going to be heading our way. We'll have much more on radar in your weekend forecast coming up.
And two former pro golfers starting a local golf academy, and it's not in Augusta. How this could be a big boost for the golf scene in Aiken in 90 seconds.
That carp out there, he did not have the best day, but bet that belly's full on that gator. We are tracking a few strong thunderstorms. This one's actually heading towards us here in Augusta. This is looking westbound down I-20. This is from our Wheeler Road cam. Starting to see a little bit of a shelf cloud form right here. So we're seeing that rain-cooled air push out ahead of this. It's sucking in that warm, humid air towards it, condensing that shelf cloud. And this storm could be intense for us. So if you live around Augusta, maybe need to take the dogs out real quick before this heavy rain starts. I do it immediately because this storm is incoming. We are already cooling off, so that rain-cooled air has moved into the airport and has helped cool temperatures off a good bit for us. We do have an active severe thunderstorm warning in effect for portions of Jefferson, Emanuel, and Johnson County. What I'm seeing on radar doesn't look too concerning for me. Definitely some very heavy rain and a lot of lightning, but I don't see a hail threat. There may be some gusty winds, but it doesn't appear like we would see anything around 60 miles an hour. So hopefully they allow this to expire fairly shortly. This is the storm I'm keeping my eye on, stretching from Appling through Harlem and near Deering there in southern McDuffie County. This has now just reached Grovetown, so you're starting to see heavy rain from it, and it is heading towards the Augusta Metro. So here in Augusta, we got about 10 minutes before our skies start to fall out. Now, it is going to be interacting with this outflow boundary, so this skinny little line you see right here as we animate that, that's going to be heading towards that storm, which can add a little bit of extra lift. It can help intensify it as well, so even though it's not severe right now, it could go severe here within the next 30 minutes or so. That outflow boundary is helping initiate some new storms through Barnwell and Bamberg County. So it's been a very quiet afternoon, but now everything is just kind of falling out of the sky. We're finally starting to see better coverage of those showers and storms, and they are going to stick with us through this evening. It's not expected to be completely clear around here until we get to around midnight. After midnight, we do look dry, but once again, any plans through this evening, watch out for these showers and storms forming and moving on through. Tonight, we're expecting lows to drop to the mid to low 70s by early tomorrow morning, and it's expected to be a few clouds out there early Saturday, so similar to how we started off our Friday. That would be the time frame to get those yard chores in, when it's not quite as hot and humid for us. Later into the afternoon, there's going to be the opportunity for some isolated storms, but not expecting a lot. So I would keep your outdoor plans for the weekend. Just keep in mind, There could be a few stray storms, but not expecting the coverage like we're seeing out there today. Those high temperatures Saturday expected to reach the mid-90s again. Factor in the humidity, you know it's going to be feeling a little bit worse than that. But keep your lake plans. Saturday and Sunday, there's going to be that opportunity for a stray storm, but not enough to cancel anything up at the lake, and those highs will be just as hot there as well. Next week, storm chances looking pretty good most afternoons, and high temperatures looking fairly seasonal.
Now that softball's in full swing. Next up is volleyball. But the indoor sport is higher risk. Mike tells us the precautions they're taking up next in sports.
On your sideline, sports brought to you by the Hawk Law Group.
So far, we talked through some of the safety protocols for both softball and football. Volleyball also represents a significant high school sport in our area. And with it being indoor, there's some extra pressure to make sure that it can be done safely. Once the Panthers were allowed to begin indoor conditioning in July, it became a priority to figure out what drills could be done while still maintaining a safe space. It's not just drills. There's even tape on the bleachers showing players where to drop their bags and water and leave enough space. Coaches are wearing masks. Some players were as well. On game day, teams will not have to switch sides or do pregame handshakes. The post-point huddle is also being eliminated. Spectators will be required to wear masks and follow best practices. It's hard to practice a true bubble like the NBA and NHL are doing at the high school level. Head coach Mo McCormick, however, is reminding her players to be wary of their decisions away from the court and away from their school.
We have been talking to them constantly about recognizing that their decisions will have outcomes. So they need to be very aware of what kind of decisions they make when they're away from Lakeside. But we're all really starting to take a lot of precautions now because we know how hard it is to lose like big assets to our team for 2 weeks of practice, especially with games coming up soon.
Volleyball competition begins on Monday for GHSA member schools. The Lakeside won't have their first games until Thursday. I'll have an SEC update and a lot more coming up tonight at 11. See you right back here then.